nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 1.7. So continuing on the topic of 2D photonic crystals, now we're going to talk about the symmetries that allow us to go from a Brillouin zone to irreducible Brillouin zone, and thus simplify the kind of calculations we have to perform. And so we can understand bandstructure symmetries in a very formal way, in fact, as like a broad set of operators that would commute with the eigenproblem operator. So if you recall the eigenproblem itself that we're using, the so-called master equation, curl of epsilon inverse curl of H, then that equation basically can be associated with an operator times H, okay? So then the curl of epsilon inverse curl is written as the operator, right? Which of course we then subsequently turn into matrix in our calculation. But before we do that, actually as a pure operator, we can actually try to commute it with various symmetry operators. And so there are several different kinds of symmetry operators that would commute with it. And then of course, we already know that because of the periodicity, we have a Brillouin zone and so on. But then what are the types of symmetries that we're interested in? So the first symmetry that may be the most obvious, maybe it's so obvious that you didn't even think of it, would be time reversal invariance. And so the reason why this is so common is because any operator that has real observables, like say in this case, like a frequency that's real, would be called Hermitian. Okay, and then Hermitian operators will always commute with a time reversal operator. So that means that if you run everything in forward or then run in reverse, then the laws are the same. So in other words, if you reflect 96% of light as it goes through glass coming from this direction, then you go back from the angle of reflection and then it'll reflect 96% again. Okay, so that's like a simple example, but it's a very abstract concept, which just tells us that we can always reverse time and thus actually simplify the band structure itself, because reversing time is actually equivalent to reversing the k vector in this case. And so then that means that omega n of k would be equal to omega n of minus k. And so that like one-to-one mapping actually allows us to cut the irreducible Brillouin zone in half. And so that alone saves us a lot of time in our calculation. But that's not the only thing that we can do. There are other types of symmetries. So another class of symmetries is called a mirror plane symmetry. And so basically the mirror plane operator is defined such that when you apply it to the H field, then you recover H, but then plus or minus one times the H field. Okay, so then you can think of the eigenvalues of the mirror operator as either being plus one or minus one. Obviously, you know, each field would have to respect one or the other of these. And it kind of makes sense if you think about it, like in a band structure calculation context, that you could have like these two classes of solutions. And in fact, we have seen them already, but I didn't say it explicitly. Basically, we had the transverse electric and transverse magnetic fields. And so in the case of transverse electric, because it's all in the plane, then that means that it would respect a mirror plane symmetry reflection, and then transverse magnetic would as well. But the difference is that transverse magnetic, when you flip it, you would get a plus one, and transverse electric, you get a minus one. And so that's giving rise to both those polarizations. But you can also do mirror planes in the plane, if you will. So you could have some structure that's like a plus sign, and so you can have reflection like both in this direction along the plus and then this direction along the plus sign, right? And so if that's like the whole symmetry of the problem, then you actually have two mirror plane symmetries. But then there's a third type of symmetry that's also very important called a rotational symmetry. And so one way to think about this very easily is just like if you can rotate the whole lattice by a certain amount of degrees. Okay, so say like 90 degrees, like in the case of a square lattice, and it's exactly the same, then we could say that has a rotational symmetry. And so, of course, it depends on the periodicity, also formerly known as the crystallographic point group. Okay, so in 2D, then it's the difference between like a square or a rectangular or a triangular lattice, right? And so, of course, the square lattice has like this fourfold rotational symmetry. You actually have sixfold symmetry for the triangular lattice. You can have a threefold symmetry for a modified triangular lattice with two basis elements. If you don't have a fourfold, threefold, or sixfold symmetry, then you don't actually have rotational symmetry for a truly periodic system. Instead, would be called a quasi-periodic system. And so if you think about a soccer balls usually have fivefold pattern, which kind of looks like a pentagon, which tiles the whole surface. But if you try to project that out into real space, you see that you can't take one unit and then see it repeated at a uniform distance away, like over and over and over again. Instead, you have like kind of a very well-ordered pattern, but it's not like perfectly periodic. And so this gives rise to some interesting phenomenon as well. Although, unfortunately, because of time, we can't cover in a lot of detail in this class, but you can certainly read up on it. There have been a number of papers about how to calculate quasi crystal band structures in the last maybe decade or so. So with that, thank you. And next lecture, we'll be discussing how to apply all these symmetries to more complex band structures.